And I hope that with this TED Talk presentation, I can show you the importance of space, I can show you what you can do for space and what it can do for you, and I can allow you to see the wonders of this great universe that we call home. But before we do that, we need to set the scene a little bit. And I hope it's gonna work. There we go. This is space. Impressive, right? So, this is space. It's the stars you see on the night sky. It's the backdrop for all your favorite sci-fi movies. And it's where you see all the rockets and astronauts going to on the news. And over the last couple of years, space has gained a completely new meaning for me. And this is what I want to share with you. So, actually, did you know that currently, we have over 128 million objects clarified as space debris floating around our orbit. There are over 10,000 satellites up in space, of which only 20% are still fully functional. And we have an arms race in space that is coming close to the Cold War. And those are just some of the things I've learned. But let me introduce myself first. This is me. My name is Chiara. I'm originally from New Zealand, and over the past decade, I've been living in both Germany and the Netherlands, and I have an immense passion for space, sustainability, and I'm also the co-founder of SDG 18, which I will talk a bit more about soon. So growing up, I've always been able to look up at the stars and kind of get this feeling of how incredibly small we are in comparison to the vast universe. I'm sure many of you have had similar feelings if you've done a bit of stargazing. And it became clear to me that space holds a lot of possibilities, but we need to take care of our actions, like with what we do on Earth as well. So I did lose touch of this specific feeling growing up because space seemed so far away, but this all changed in May 2020. So I'm actually a Global Project and Change Management alumni, as most of you know. I did my bachelor's here. And now I'm currently doing a master's at Maastricht University on the topic of sustainability. And in May 2020, like I said, during the Value Creator semester, me and three fellow students co-founded an initiative called SDG 18, Space for All. Kind of began with the idea where we're thinking, what can we do? Where can we create value? And suddenly we came to the topic of, but what about space? Now, what about space? Thinking like that's stars, NASA, Elon Musk. But is there more to it? And yes, yes, there was. So we did a lot of research, and what we found out about space, and especially space sustainability, was quite amazing, and that there's quite a big need for a focus on the space sustainability. So we reached out to the UN, we did a webinar, we gathered a lot of information, we talked to people from the sector, and realized, yes, space sustainability is a big focus, and we need to look at this now. So that is what has happened. Over the past 1.5 years, I've been talking to a lot of people, giving a lot of speeches, creating awareness, and we see a lot more initiatives growing on the topic of space sustainability as well. And great news is I will be doing a PhD on this topic starting end of this year, so hopefully we'll actually make it a reality to get it on the global agenda. Thank you. apart from that, I did my bachelor's thesis together with the Office of Astronomy for Development, looking at specifically at how astronomy and the SDGs link together and where this could be of greater benefit. And we saw that there were so many linking points and that astronomers can actually use the SDGs as a tool for communication for their projects. Then I also co-started our initiative called Spacefluencers, which is a community of space-interested students looking to learn together, to educate others, to visit schools, and to grow this community. And we have a big partnership with the World Summit AI, which is in Amsterdam every year, so we can give presentations, and it's really cool. It's super sci-fi as well. We have a little robot dog. It's very fun. And as of 1 year, I am now also a space journalist at Spacewatch Global, which is an independent information platform for space news. So if any of you want to check it out, we have very fun stuff. But now, I mean, I can talk about this forever, and you see, I'm very excited, but why should we care? Why focus on space if we have so many problems facing our planet? We see it with all the other SDGs. Why should we care? Now, I'm here to tell you. With all these issues that we're facing, with climate change, poverty, forest fires, global health risks, just to name a few things, space is very important. Now, space technology is actually all around you. Imagine this, you're checking on your phone to find that cafe where you're meant to meet your friend. Would not be possible without space. Or you're at home watching Netflix on your laptop. Also not possible without space. Or you're in the grocery store trying to pay for your groceries with your bank card. Also not possible without space. So space affects our everyday lives. But also on a larger scale, space helps. So when we talk about climate change, satellites give us more information about the effects of climate change than we can measure from Earth. For example, we cannot calculate the thickness of the ice layers on the poles without satellite information. Now, when it comes to poverty, satellites help to forecast natural disasters, coordinate help, and optimize the best use of natural resources. They can also map populated areas and their access to basic services. So overall, space technology can actually help contribute to the prevention of people falling below the poverty line and help target specific response and crisis support. When it comes to forest fires, the remote sensing technology is amazing. It's not uncommon for an Earth-observing satellite to spot a wildfire before anyone else. And if we're talking about global health and also a global pandemic, Earth observation can track all the changes caused by the COVID-19 crisis. And there have been many medical breakthroughs that would have not been possible without space. For example, digital imaging in a biopsy surgery that was discovered through the Hubble Space Telescope technology. And also when we're talking about new medical developments, growing cells in microgravity is actually an amazing thing. So if you grow cells on Earth, they grow 2D, like in the Petri dishes. But if you grow them in space in microgravity, they grow 3D. So I actually have a good friend who's starting a company to help women who have suffered from breast cancer so that they can make implants using their own cells in space, and so the body takes these on a lot quicker than fake implants. So there's so many possibilities. And Earth observation is also just as beautiful as it is educational. So this is a glacier located on the southern end of the southern Patagonian ice field in Argentina. This is the sediment swirls of the Yucatan Peninsula. Here we have a view of Plymouth, Massachusetts. And I think this one is my favorite so far, which is the strong tides that are creating turbulent flows in the water off Eastern Asia. But now, what about what you can do in and for space? Because the job market has so many possibilities. Now, of course, most of you thinking maybe you can become an astronaut, which of course is awesome. But basically, any job that you can do here on Earth, you can do in and for space. I'm just going to name a few examples, but if you have any more questions, feel free to reach out to me later. So I'm a space journalist. That means I'm writing about what is happening in space, what are new developments. I get to talk to astronauts, both the ones that are here on Earth and the ones that are still up at the ISS, and just find out more and share this content. But there are people who are space lawyers, who are looking at the laws in space and looking at space arbitration. There are space artists who are working on art projects about space debris, about sending voice messages into space, who are rapping about astrophysics. You have space biologists looking at what you can grow in space, space doctors, but even space project managers and space sustainability consultants. So anything you can think of, you can do for space, and it just sounds so much cooler as well. Now, on a slightly negative point that we do need to address, as mentioned before, there are a few issues facing space. And this is not our fault, but humanity's fault, because we are expanding into that domain. So, there are currently 5 international treaties and 5 principles on activity in space, dealing with issues that can ensure, such as arms control, liability for damage caused by space debris, exploitation of natural resources, and so on and so forth. Now, the last treaty went into force in 1984, and the last principle was added in 1996. That's 3 years before I was born. So this is a long time ago, considering the speed of technological advancements and the increased access to and interest in space. And if these rules and regulations are not up to date, this can cause a lot of problems. If we're talking maybe about military use of space, or also the use of natural resources, or even space mining. Now, there are some initiatives growing, but this is not yet on a level where it is globally ensured that there are fixed rules and regulations. They're only guidance. So a lot of work to be done. Now, the other big pressing issue that many of you might have already heard of is space debris. Even one small piece, be it 1 millimeter or 1 centimeter, can cause a lot of damage. So at this moment, there are over the 128 million objects floating around our orbit, most of which are defined as space debris. And not all of them can be tracked either. That's another big problem. And these pose a big threat to future exploration missions, to the International Space Station, and especially also to all those satellites that we need for our everyday lives. And most of the objects, like I said, are even too small to be registered, but they have such a high velocity that they can cause a lot of damage. And one big thing that scientists speak of is the Kessler syndrome, which is that the space junk is growing exponentially, because as soon as one small piece and another small piece hit each other, they break off into even smaller pieces, and this continues. So we need to be wary, because otherwise we're running out of space on our orbital highway. There's too much trash there. We cannot control where our satellites go. Now, also on this point, there are some things being done. There are some actions being taken to try and clear space debris. Now, the funny and sad thing is that all of these actions so far have only created more space debris. So there was this great idea of having a net to catch the debris, and now the net is also floating around in orbit. So there is going to be the first ever clean space mission being launched from ESA. So hopefully that will be a success, and we will see that happening in the future. But at the same time, we do need to prevent causing even more debris in space. So as you see, space does hold a lot of benefits and a vast amount of opportunities. But we do need to be wary to protect that area that offers us all these possibilities. And I know it is sometimes a bit difficult to grasp, much like maybe an ant cannot really fathom the size of your garden. Us humans find it very hard to grasp the concept of infinity. But I feel like it does make you feel like you're part of something bigger, right? So, 59 years ago, the first men entered outer space, and this is what they saw. Earth, this magnificent celestial body teeming with life, in just this vast ocean of black nothingness. There are no borders to be seen, no conflicts, no struggles. It's just oneness. And Neil Armstrong, astronaut and moonwalker, had this quote. He said, "It suddenly struck me that that tiny pea, pretty and blue, was the Earth. I put out my thumb and shut one eye, and it blotted out planet Earth. But I didn't feel like a giant. I felt very, very small." See, astronauts, when they see this, they immediately sense the fragility of Earth and this overwhelming urge to protect it. And this is what they call the overview effect. So now I call to all of you to close your eyes and to imagine you are in a position of these astronauts. Visualize the sight that they see, this tiny blue planet floating around, this planet you call home. And know that we are part of a bigger system. We are all travelers on this spaceship Earth, and we are space. I hope that you remember this for your next endeavors. Ad astra et ultra. Thank you so much. So, any questions? Or impressions or comments? Yes.
Yeah. I'm always in limbo between the thoughts that we need to gain knowledge and develop new technologies by going to space. But mm-hmm. also very much concerned about massive use of fuels to get out of Earth gravity zones. And what can we do to reduce that enormous pollution that space to
I mean, for one, discovering new technological advancements, and also in terms of propulsion, there's more work being done also on, for example, electrical propulsion instead of the normal rocket fuel. But also a lot of plans for in-orbit manufacturing and servicing, so that we at some point don't even need to always fly a rocket out from Earth, but that we have everything to build our satellites and rockets up in space already. So it's much less of this traffic that is happening.
For a guy who grew up with reading the books of Jules Verne.
Yeah.
It's a little bit like Jules Verne.
I mean, honestly, most of the sci-fi that you know is actually coming to life or is already in planning. It's, okay. Yeah.
Well,
it's quite impressive.
Start reading your journalistic article.
Yes, you should. Yeah.
Okay. What do you think about the role space in the global cooperation? For example, right now, like the war in Ukraine, right? But in the ISS, there's still very much a collaboration atmosphere, very different than on Earth. What's the role space in this?
I think space has always been that sphere of international collaboration and oneness. I mean, also just from this imagery, right, that once you're up there, the conflicts don't really matter. So it's always been this place where everyone works together, especially with the International Space Station. However, now with the current conflict, we're really seeing that also reaching its limits. I mean, also from the whole issues with the Russian space agency, Roscosmos, and the statements they were putting out about wanting to deorbit the space station, you do see that it's slightly transferring, so I'm really hoping that we'll still manage to keep that global collaboration intact, because that is what space is. I mean, we're just on this one planet in a giant galaxy, so I hope. So far it has been, it still is. I think the astronauts that are on the ISS don't have these animosities, but from what is happening from Earth, that is causing some trouble. I think there was another question for us.
Yeah. Yeah, you mentioned
so the mission that's going to launch soon, the Clean Space mission, is actually almost like an octopus. So it's like this spaceship that has all these tentacles, and it will grab a piece of space debris and drag it out so that it burns up in the atmosphere. And that is what they're hoping is now going to work and be the first mission that actually doesn't create more debris than it tries to reduce. Yeah.
What could we do to prevent that, especially the richer countries in the world, actually colonize space? And what is needed in your opinion?
That's a really good question. That's also what my thesis is on right now. yes, because this is another big problem we're seeing. We have some space superpowers that are already quite established that are now making rules for the rest, but of course a lot of countries are trying to also become spacefaring nations. And I think one thing that is really necessary is a new set of global guidelines and rules, because a lot of countries are now creating their own national space strategies. Some, I mean, there's like the Artemis Accords, which are very US-centered, so America wants everyone to sign them, but a lot of countries are like, no. So I think like these UN bodies that we have, like the UN Office for Outer Space Affairs and on the Committee for Peaceful Uses of Outer Space, they are working on a lot of rules and regulations, and that needs to be standardized to give everyone a fair chance to still become a spacefaring nation, but in a more sustainable way. Yeah. Yes, that is also part of SDG18. So yeah, hopefully more to come. Yes. There's so many. But I think especially the whole medicine aspect is super cool. Like when I was talking about my friend who's like growing these cells, so you take a cell from your own body and you can grow it up in space, but in 3D. So cool. I mean, so that's something that I've recently learned about and I'm super fascinated on it. But also, yeah, definitely. So it has a lot of different implications. And I think also different propulsion systems is also very interesting to see of how can you get away from the typical use of fuel and maybe use what space offers as well. So there's a lot of interesting developments and really cool startups as well. There's so many startups coming up around upstream and downstream of space. Yeah. Oh, yes. Good question. Yeah, I think in terms of trends, especially in terms of trends for sustainability, we're seeing much more concrete awareness for the topics of space debris and also space traffic management. Because right now, if two satellites are going to crash into each other, it's like, yeah. Who moves? Is it the older one? Is it the newer one? Is it the one that's faster? You have to discuss in every single case. So you have to call them up and say, like, you should probably move your satellite. So that's a big thing where a lot of conferences are going. I think especially from a Europe-focused perspective, Europe is realizing that they're very far behind. And so European space is trying to catch up again, especially through the European Space Agency. They have their new agenda 2025, where they're really focusing on sustainability, on crisis management. So we see more steps towards sustainability, or at least towards more concrete legislations. And then in terms of what education can do, well, talk about it. I think that's a big thing. I would have loved to have something about space in primary school already. I think it would be nice to just at least drop those hints of inspiration, or at least show what's happening and show how important it is. I mean, even for our program, when we're talking about the SDGs, space contributes to every single one of them. I mean, it's just the data that we have. So to make that more visible would really help a great deal, because most people do not realize that it's so interconnected. And I think that would already, yeah, create a great benefit. No, it's a fair question, and it's a question I get quite often, but to the point of should we care about it, should we do it, it's too late. We are already in space. We're very active in space already. This is, I mean, the first people landed on the moon 60 years ago. We're doing this. So we should also start really stepping up our game and caring about how we're doing it. And that is, and because it's so interconnected, I mean, you cannot really separate Earth from space because it's in one big ecosystem. So I think it's important to understand. And yes, we're by far not perfect on Earth. I mean, environmental law, just from the legislation perspective, is still a baby. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't also start working on space and at least attempting to salvage and to save this wonderful ecosystem. Okay. To the stars and beyond. Well, thank you so much for all your questions. And if you have any more questions or you want to find out more, find the space dress.
She's still here. Thank you, Chiara.
Thanks.
Very nice. The next TED Talk will be in 10 minutes. So we have 10 more minutes. And the next TED Talk will be, let me see, Laura Jane van Dijk, which is an unconventional journey on the labor market, and it's in English. So see you in 9 minutes already.